Hello and welcome to Business 360. I'm Shireen Bhan. The headlines that we're tracking for you this evening: the Sensex slides over 800 points, falling below 65,000. The Nifty loses over 250 points, ending at its lowest level in 2 months. Mid-caps get battered with the index losing 3%, 8 lakh crore rupees in market cap wiped out in what has been the worst single-day fall since January. Stocks decline across the world after the U.S. 10-year bond yield shoots past 5% for the first time in over 15 years. Crude oil prices remain stubborn. Global gold prices on the rise, within striking distance of a record high in India. The Indian government hints at a potential cut to capital expenditure. Sources say states have been asked to utilize unspent funds before seeking additional money, also adding that expenditure needs to be scaled down and it is not feasible to continue with higher capex in the medium term. Officials in Gaza claim 400 people are dead in the last 24 hours as Israeli airstrikes continue. The White House promises continued flow of aid into Gaza as a second convoy carrying essentials enters from Egypt. Leaders from US, UK, France, among others, call on Israel to uphold international law and protect civilians while also reiterating Israel's right to defend itself. Kotak Mahindra Bank tanks in trade, RBI's approval of Ashok Vaswani, an outsider CEO surprises Street, which had been expecting an internal candidate to succeed Kotak. A former Barclays banker, Vaswani's technology focus, global exposure is likely to have tilted the scales in his favour. Vedanta looks set to lose its third CFO in 3 years, as per Bloomberg. Sonal Srivastava, who joined the company in June, informed Chairman Anil Agarwal last month about a decision to leave. Vedanta faces about $3 billion of bond repayments in the next 2 years and has announced a mega business restructuring plan. The 49-year-old scion of the Vag Bakri Tea Group, Parag Desai, no more. He died due to a brain hemorrhage after slipping while trying to ward off stray dogs in Ahmedabad. America and UK say the Indian move to seek reduction in Canada's diplomatic presence is inconsistent with international law. The government cites continuous interference in India's affairs. External Affairs Minister says the suspension of visa services for Canadians is in line with the Vienna Convention, adding the government was reviewing the security situation which led to the suspension. The BJP faces a backlash over ticket distribution in poll-bound Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. Supporters of poll aspirants protest outside residences of Jyotiraditya Sindhia, Rajyavardhan Rathore, among others. Some Congress workers also protest over ticket allocation in MP. Air quality in Delhi worsens to very poor. The State Environment Minister Gopal Rai says 13 hotspots identified as the worst affected promises action. Mumbai's air quality remains poor but improves compared to last week. Veteran spinner and former Test captain Bishan Singh Bedi dies at the age of 77. A member of the legendary Indian spin quartet, Bedi played 67 Tests and 10 one-day internationals. Well, let's start with the market action for the day. The Sensex down over 800 points and the Nifty lost about 250 points as the market started the week with a sell-off. If you take a look at the mid-caps, also battered in trade today, the index down 3%. So the Sensex losing about 825, the Nifty down 260 points, the Nifty Bank losing almost 600 points, the Nifty mid-cap index down 1,000 points, over 1,000 points today. All in all, stocks on the BSE have seen their market cap go down by 8 lakh crore rupees and this is the worst fall since January. Prashant is standing by now to take us through the market action and what led to today's significant fall. Prashanta, what spooked the markets today?
Completely down and out day for the markets today. No place to hide, really. That kind of a session. So Nifty will come up on your screen, down about 1.3%. Selling intensified in the last 45 minutes of trade. Similar is the case with the Nifty Bank, which also sold off hard. Now, the last portion of the selling came through right after, the selling started right after the US 10-year hit the 5% level, the first since 2007, and that is the global risk-free rate around which most of the financial assets are anchored one way or the other. And of course, the fear is that the reasons behind, the both technical and fundamental reasons behind the rise in bond yields in the US will remain valid, operative for the next couple of months. We heard from Fed Chair Powell last Thursday, and he doesn't think that financial conditions, and I quote, are too tight. And the fear is that rates here, perhaps even higher, will stay higher for longer. Broader markets, right? Mid-caps and small-caps had it even worse. Mid-cap index down 2.6, small-cap index selling off even more. And that's where bulk of the problem was. So this is the largest selling in, for those two indices since the 12th of September, where those indices sold off 4%. 10 is to 1, declines to advances. Market breadth was very bad. Lots of actively traded stocks, well-owned stocks, down between 10 and 15%. I'll get to stocks in a bit. Earnings at the margin have not been all that great, right? So in recent memory, Lauris, Havells, Emphasis, Kajaria, Voltas, Astral, disappointments really compared to consensus expectations. And of course, positives coming through only through in Bajaj. I mean, that was a big surprise. And of course, Polycab at the margin also beat expectations. Remember, stocks have done very well. And that's the basic backdrop against which these stocks have corrected. So the top worst hit losers on your screen, Lauris, GMDC, SJVN, IRB, India Bulls Housing, Amber sold off aggressively. These banks, Bank of India, Central Bank, ITI down 10%, RCF, PNB Gills, Alembic Limited. There was BEML, which was down sharply. Iron Exchange down 10, Schneider down. Sugar stocks, Dhampur, Dwarikesh down, and something like a Star Cement sold off as well. Well, tomorrow is a market holiday, and I think we'll watch what US markets do very, very closely, global markets really. And even there, I think what will matter the most is US bond yields. We'll have 2 days of those reactions to react to when we come back on Wednesday morning. Back to you.
Prashant, many thanks for joining us. Yes, our markets are closed for trade tomorrow. And as Prashant was pointing out, we will have to contend with global cues when we resume trade on Wednesday morning. On to the action from the commodity markets. Oil prices easing marginally but remaining elevated. The conflict in the Middle East and the war in Ukraine continue to be the key concerns, even as the U.S. has improved supply from Venezuela and other markets. Global oil major Chevron, meanwhile, will buy rival Hess Corp in a $53 billion all-stock deal. Chevron will offer $171 for every Hess share. This implies a premium of about 5%. The company said in a statement that Hess Corp CEO John Hess is expected to join Chevron's board of directors once the deal is done. So that's a big deal there in the oil and gas space. From crude now to gold prices, global gold price has been on the rise since the Israel-Hamas conflict spurred concerns of a spillover. In India, meanwhile, the prices are within a striking distance of a record high as the festive season demand has kicked off. Manisha Gupta is standing by now with the details. Manisha, take us through what experts are telling you on where gold prices are possibly headed.
Gold prices have been an up move because of three reasons. One, there are geopolitical concerns and that leads to safe haven buying. Second, expectation that you could be looking at lower interest rates in 2024. And third, in last 1 year, the gold prices have given you better returns than various asset classes. So portfolio diversification also has led gold on the higher side. And while we are inching higher, some of the countries and currencies have seen gold prices already hitting record highs. Australia, Japan and China in last 1 week have been looking at higher gold prices consistently. In this year, we also have seen UK and Taiwan as countries see gold prices at all-time highs. For the Indian markets as well, it was in the month of May that we saw 61,490 as an all-time high. Currently, we are trading at 60,500, so just 1,000 rupees away from an all-time high there. In the US dollar terms, the all-time high has been 2070. We are trading at around 1980 right now, so $1,000 away from that one as well. But interestingly, it is the projections going forward which tell you that the gold is ready to make all-time high in the next year as well. I mean, as you can see, these are all global banks and brokerages, Wall Street banks as well, telling you that gold prices will hit a high at around $2,200 an ounce. I mean, that really seems to be a consensus. But there are a couple of them which also expect that $2,500 an ounce of an all-time high is also what gold prices could be looking at in the next year. So this is the projection anticipating that it's an all-time high coming in for 2024 for gold yet again.
All right, Manisha, many thanks for joining us. Well, all that glitters currently is gold. Now, the government has hinted at a potential cut to capital expenditure. Government sources have said that states have been asked to utilize unspent funds before seeking any additional money. Sapna standing by now with details. Sapna, you know, we have seen CapEx being at record highs, but sustainable in the medium to long term?
I think the overall message that's coming out from the central government is one of fiscal prudence at this point in time. First, states have been told to, you know, make sure that they utilize their idle funds, take stock of their idle funds and make sure that all the unspent money is first utilized before they ask for additionality from the central government. That's one. Second, working on debt levels, bringing it down. Of course, that's more of a long-term goal, but, you know, keeping in mind what the finance minister said, that we should not be profligate and leave a debt burden for future generations to pay off. So that's something. But however, on that front also, the government will not have too many options except for tweaking expenditure at some point in time. The third, of course, is very strong and solid, and that is basically the central government may not be able to keep up the high pace of capex that they have done in the last two odd years. So if you look at the numbers, FY22 under 6 lakh odd crore worth of direct central government capex, that number stands at 10 lakh crore in this budget. You'll have to wait and watch and see how the RE numbers pan out. But this is something that the central government is now beginning to indicate that it may not be possible to sustain this high level of capex, basically meaning that the private sector should step in. Last but not the least, however, as far as the current financial year is concerned, they do expect to remain within the food subsidy budget. Some additional allocation for MGNREGA may be feasible, but within the fiscal limits. And last but not the least, central government is still sticking to the 5.9% fiscal deficit aim for this financial year.
Sapna, many thanks for joining us. Now, the death toll in the Israel-Hamas war has crossed 6,000 as Israeli airstrikes continue unabated in the Gaza Strip. Israel has claimed that it attacked over 300 targets in the Gaza Strip in just the last 24 hours. The Hamas-run Gaza Health Ministry has claimed that around 40% of Palestinians killed in the war so far are children. Shell fragments from an Israeli tank have hit the Egyptian border, injuring at least 7 people. The Israeli military said it was an accident. The US, UK, France, Canada and Germany have urged Israel to adhere to international law and protect civilians. During a phone call with Joe Biden, Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu agreed to allow humanitarian aid into the war-battered Gaza Strip. Meanwhile, humanitarian aid has begun trickling into Gaza over the weekend. The UN says that the aid is just a fraction of what is needed for over 2 million Palestinians. Protests continue across several cities in Europe and the Middle East seeking an immediate ceasefire in the Gaza Strip.
Part of the infrastructure and part of the aid is hijacked by Hamas. That's the issue. Guys, it's very easy to blame Israel.
I'd like to warn the United States of America and its regional proxy, the fake regime of Israel, that if they don't immediately halt crimes against humanity and ethnic cleansing in Gaza, anything would be possible at any moment.
Expresses its extreme astonishment that the world stands by and watches a catastrophic humanitarian crisis affecting 2.5 million Palestinians in the Gaza Strip.
The conflict continues. Now back home, the Reserve Bank has approved the appointment of Ashok Vaswani as the new CEO and Managing Director of Kotak Mahindra Bank. This development took place over the weekend. Abhishek Kothari joins us now with more on Vaswani and how the street has reacted to his appointment. A surprise, Abhishek, an external candidate appointed as CEO of Kotak Mahindra Bank.
Ashok Vaswani's appointment as the MD and CEO of Kotak Bank has come in as a surprise, as most expected an internal candidate to take over. Let's take a look as to who is Ashok Vaswani and the implication of this move. First, who is Ashok Vaswani? Ashok Vaswani is a chartered accountant and a company secretary with executive education from Stanford. He's a career banker of 35 years who has served as the CEO of Citigroup's operation in the Asia-Pacific region, later as the CEO at Barclays Bank in the United Kingdom, demonstrating his leadership in a prominent global financial institution before leading Barclays Global Consumer Corporate and Payments businesses, indicating his expertise across various segments of banking. At present, he is the president of Pagaya Technologies, which is an artificial intelligence fintech company with operations in both the United States and Israel. But why is his appointment such a big surprise? Now, it was widely anticipated that the top job would go to an internal contender, and there were two names seen in the running. Shanti Ekambaram, head of consumer banking, and KVS Manian, president of global transaction banking. But where does Kotak Mahindra Bank stand today, and what does Ashok Vaswani have to contend with? Let's take a look. Kotak Bank has a strong retail franchisee and a significant market share of more than 2% each in deposits and advances. It has a lower stress level when compared to its peers like SMA or restructuring. The key challenges include addressing the declining low-cost deposit share and coping with the emerging competition from fintechs. What is Ashok Vaswani expected to do to address the challenges? Now, here's what leaders at the bank have to say. The bank's founder and former CEO, that is MD and CEO, Mr. Uday Kotak, says that the aim is to bring a global Indian home to drive Kotak's and India's future. Now, Prakash Apte, who is the chairman, says that he is confident that Vaswani will accelerate change and drive growth. While Deepak Gupta, the present MD and CEO of the bank, says that Kotak's vision to transform into a tech-enabled, consumer-centric financial institution. But analysts tracking the bank have made some observations and flagged some concerns on this surprise announcement. First, they see the choice of CEO being driven by the need to push for a tech transformation in the bank, which is in line with the industry trends. However, Vaswani's limited recent exposure to Indian ground realities could actually be a drawback, as the banking landscape in India is unique. Convincing the current team to embrace the change may also be a challenge. Vaswani has a limited runway as CEO, considering there is an age cap of 70 years in the banking sector and is already 63. Overall, the banking industry will be closely watching the transformation or the transition under Ashok Vaswani's leadership of Kotak Mahindra Bank, as the bank aims to stay competitive and adapt to the evolving financial landscape.
Abhishek, many thanks for joining us. A new innings there for Ashok Vaswani as he starts his tenure as CEO of Kotak Mahindra Bank. Now, the 49-year-old scion of the Vag Bakri Tea Group, Parag Desai, is no more. He died due to a brain hemorrhage after slipping while trying to ward off stray dogs in Ahmedabad. The Vag Bakri Group has an annual turnover of 2,000 crore rupees. Desai was spearheading the company's sales, marketing and export departments. Veena Deshpande gets us more.
Condolence messages have been pouring in since the news of the unfortunate and untimely demise of Parag Desai, the executive director of Vag Bakri Tea Company. He was 49. He died yesterday at a private hospital in Ahmedabad, a week after he suffered brain hemorrhage when he was reportedly attacked by stray dogs and he was trying to fend those attacks off. He was thereafter admitted to the hospital where he was allegedly kept on a ventilator for some time. He lost his life due to several health complications yesterday at another private hospital in Ahmedabad. He survived by his wife and daughter. He was the fourth generation member of Desai family and had taken over the reins of the business when the revenue was just 100 crore. He was one of the executive directors who had led the company's transformation into tea lounges and e-commerce. The business grew by leaps and bounds thereafter. He was an avid tea taster and was very passionate about environment and education. He did his MBA from the US and thereafter joined the family business in 1990s. The Instagram handle of Vag Bakri Tea Company officially announced the sad demise today.
Well, a terrible tragedy there. It's time now for us to head into a break. But up next, air quality in Delhi worsens to very poor. Mumbai's air quality remains poor but improves compared to last week. That and more when we return. Air quality in Delhi has worsened to very poor. The state environment minister Gopal Rai said that 13 hotspots have been identified as the worst affected and has promised to take action. The government has also decided to use dust suppressant powder to prevent dust pollution in the city. Meanwhile, Mumbai's air quality continues to remain poor but has improved marginally compared to last week. The BMC has introduced mist spraying dust suppressing vehicles that will be used in South Mumbai between Worli and Fort. Rachna Dhanrajani is here with more.
After almost a week of the entire city of Mumbai complaining of a bad AQI, the BMC has finally woken up to providing solutions to this environmental crisis. Behind me is a dust suppression machine, which is spraying mist in the air in order to suppress the dust and pollutant particles floating in the air. Let's have a look at this machine. Now, this machine is being rehashed from the COVID-19 era, when the same machine was used to spread sanitizers around the city, but this time they're putting just water. This machine comes with a capacity of 1,000 liters of water and will be plying between Worli Sea Face to Fort in Mumbai. That's a stretch of about 10 to 15 kilometers, and that's all this machine can do in one round. Now, the timings that have been fixed for this machine are 6:30 in the morning in order to avoid the office crowd, because as you can see, the mist makes the ground quite wet and the passerbys can technically get drenched in this water. Apart from 6:30 in the morning, the machine plies again around lunch, which is about 2:30, and two other timings are still being decided for the machine to spray the mist around the city. Now, this is one of its kind because this is a pilot project that BMC has started by a third-party contractor. But apart from this, five other machines, which were again used during COVID-19, will be rehashed to suppress dust now as the city goes through a bad AQI. Those machines will be slightly different. They won't be spraying out mist, but actual water in terms of a sprinkler. This one sprays out mist specifically, which makes it slightly better. But as you can see, the sprinkler is angled at about 45 degrees, so it makes all the people traveling by two-wheelers sort of drenched. In Mumbai, Rachna Dhanrajani.
Well, poor air quality continues to concern citizens across cities in India. With that, it is time for us to wrap up this edition of Business 360. Thanks very much for watching. Stay tuned to CNBC TV 18. The news will continue on the other side.